And now, the way it used to be, here's Joey.
Joey with you here on this lovely Friday, October 23rd. I hope you're doing fine out there. All our listeners from all over the wonderful United States and other parts, too. A lot of fans in Germany and Vietnam. And we go out all over here on Vegas Allnet Radio. So please listen every Friday between 4 and 6. And we're showing those YouTube shows up there that you're going to love. And check those out so you get a look and you get a glimpse of what's going on. A little early again. I always say it every Friday. You got Halloween coming up. So be safe out there, man. When you're giving that candy out and doing, you know, all those things, or you're out there collecting the candy, let's put it that way. Be safe either way, okay? right off the bat, 18 years ago, had this little girl, and today's a special day for me. So Lola Ciccone out there in Wisconsin, Stevens Point, and to all your friends that are listening at Stevens Point University, I want to say I love you. Happy birthday, my dear. 18 years old. Wow. It's been a long time. It's been a long time, but you got a lot going on, baby, ahead of you. Happy birthday. We're going to get to talk to you after a little bit, okay? So make sure you give us a call in. You got the time. And for all my friends out there, our number here at the studio is 702-483-4444. We love to, while you're driving, wherever you're at home, on the computer, whatever, call in, give a shout, okay? Not going to tell you who my guest is. I'm going to be bringing him in, but you're going to be seeing a clip, what he's about, that's coming up here, and then you're going to hear a nice little song by Joey, and then I'm going to have my wonderful, wonderful guest. It's going to be a very, very cool, cool Friday, cool show, little mob vibe going on. I'm not in the tux, all right? So anyway, we're going to roll on to something done by a gentleman named Frank Collada. It was some work that he did. I don't know. It tells a story. Check it out.
Remorse? He follows his ruthless mob boss, Tony the Ant Spulatro, to Las Vegas for a glittering opportunity to live the high life.
First year in Las Vegas, it was good. Made a lot of money. Did a lot of partying. Did a lot of gambling. Yeah, it was very good.
But his hopes for hitting the jackpot die.
But then it got to be very bad.
Yeah. When his boss decides to take him out.
Clean your dirty laundry.
But breaking the mob's code of silence could mean the death of his dark American dream and the end of the entire Chicago outfit.
Do I consider myself a rat? Absolutely.
In Chicago, thanks to bootlegging, Tommy guns, and extreme violence, organized crime first makes a name for itself in the 1920s. Led by the infamous Al Capone, the Chicago mob is known as the Outfit. Under Capone's leadership, the Outfit earns a reputation as the most dangerous mafia gang in the world. By 1975, the Outfit orders the killing of their own boss, Sam Giancana, as he is about to testify for the FBI. That same year, they allegedly orchestrate the disappearance of union leader Jimmy Hoffa. In the 1970s, the Outfit sets its sights on Las Vegas.
Well, the Chicago Outfit's interest in Las Vegas was primarily the operation of the skimming at the hotels that they controlled.
Dennis Arnoldi is a retired FBI agent assigned at the time to the Las Vegas Division.
I worked in the area of organized crime, specifically the Chicago Outfit.
In the 1970s, the Outfit controls three casinos in Las Vegas. Mob boss Tony the Ant Spulatro runs their operations on the Strip. Despite his small stature that earned him his nickname, Spulatro is a notoriously ruthless enforcer for the Outfit.
Tony Spulatro was a tough guy. He could really handle himself.
In 1971, Spulatro sets up shop in Vegas to handle the Outfit's business there, fencing stolen goods, extorting locals, and skimming gambling profits. By 1979, business is booming for the Outfit, but Spulatro needs more muscle to control the casinos. He turns to his childhood friend from Chicago, Frank Collada. Culotta is a second-generation criminal, loyal to the Mafia's code of complete obedience and willing to do whatever it takes to please Spilotro.
Frank Culotta was cold-blooded, he was a killer, he was a criminal. Tony trusted Frank to do the right thing for the outfit.
And I said, what are you expecting out of me out here? What's my function going to be? He first of all wanted me to watch his back to make sure that he wouldn't get whacked. He also wanted me to keep in contact with pit bosses, casino managers, and the Stardust. What I've learned about being connected to the outfit is you definitely had to follow the protocol. If you went against it, you were going to get either reprimanded, beaten up, or killed.
Culotta also realizes there is money to be made in Vegas for himself and the outfit, which gets a cut of any crime an associate commits.
It did look like easy pickings, probably, to the Chicago outfit.
You know, everybody wants to move to Vegas. It was a town, you know, people think the streets are lined with gold. Sure, I thought it was a great opportunity to live in Vegas.
The exploits of Culotta and his boss, Tony Spilotro, became the basis for Martin Scorsese's 1995 film, Casino. In the movie, the character based on Tony Spilotro was played by Joe Pesci, and Frank Culotta by actor Frank Vincent. And just like in the film, the real mobsters have Vegas in their back pockets.
A lot of money was going out through the skimming, and they wanted to make sure that it was getting back to them in Chicago.
So far, local law enforcement is powerless to stop the mob's reign over Sin City. But a crackdown is coming, one that will eventually weaken the outfit's hold on Vegas forever. In Vegas, Tony Spilotro asks Culotta to put together a crew of the best criminals he can find, a team that would come to be known as the Hole in the Wall Gang.
Back in the early 80s, alarm systems were not as sophisticated as they are today. Frank Culotta's crew understood this. Therefore, they would often just bash a hole in the side of the wall. Therefore, they earned the nickname as the Hole in the Wall Gang.
Culotta's team will also function as professional enforcers for the outfit.
The guys in my crew that I put together, one was a master burglar. His name was Leo. The other one was a soldier, Ernie. Wayne was also an armed robber with a clean face. When I say clean face, he could give up face to pull an armed robbery because he lived in Chicago. He'd come back and forth. Then I had Larry. He was a killer. No different than a serial killer. Loved to kill.
Close your eyes.
Frank's crew in Las Vegas certainly would deal with people that they felt had stolen money from the mob, cheated the mob, that type of thing. They were used for that type of situations.
Spilotro also plans to use Culotta's crew to earn some easy money. He guarantees them a piece of the action, and then he sets the Hole in the Wall Gang loose on Las Vegas. For Culotta, it's a chance to live it up in Las Vegas and improve his standing in the mob. As long as he stays on the good side of Spilotro and the Chicago outfit, the opportunities seem endless.
We robbed a lot of drug dealers. They were the easiest ones to rob. We robbed everything there was to be robbed as long as there was money involved. First year in Las Vegas was good, made a lot of money.
Heads up!
A lot of money. We robbed a lot of jewelry stores. It was very good. The one who makes the most money's got the most power. It's all about money.
Culotta's crime spree makes him a rising star in the Vegas criminal world. And the job comes with perks.
Did a lot of partying, did a lot of gambling. I had a lot of girls around me. You know, they wanted to be around wise guys. It was a glamorous life.
But Culotta's increasing status in the outfit is threatened after he becomes involved with a small-time crook and drug dealer named Jerry Lisner.
Jerry Lisner was a individual in Las Vegas. He had a reputation as a con man.
I was introduced to this Lisner guy, and I didn't like this guy very much because I could see he was sort of like a weasel.
He approached Frank one time regarding a scam he was going to run.
When Lisner found out who I was connected to, meaning Tony Spilotro, he latched on to me.
But Spilotro and Culotta find out that Lisner is cooperating with the feds.
Jerry Lisner testified in a federal grand jury. At that point, Frank and Tony were concerned about what he might have said.
He's, we gotta kill him.
Culotta, following mob rules, obeys Spilotro.
I never got any joy out of killing people. That's just what I had to do. I mean, if I was ordered to do it, whatever it was, I'd have to do it. Motion goes out the window.
Hey, Frank. How you doing, baby?
All right, how are you?
With his lookout man, Wayne, outside, Culotta moves in for the kill. Culotta, always the loyal soldier, carries out his orders.
I shoot him in the head. First two went in there, they were rapid, real fast. Bang, bang. He's running.
What are you doing? What?
He's still running, and I know I'm shooting him in the head. And I just can't understand why nothing's happening.
Murdering Lisner proves more difficult than expected.
Natural reaction for anybody, if you're this far into a murder, is to complete it. So the best thing I could do is strangle him. The cord just snapped. Meanwhile, there's blood all over the place.
Then, Culotta hears someone enter the apartment.
My first reaction when the door was open was get myself in a defense mood where I could attack. And it was Wayne. If somebody else came in that door, I would have had to kill him.
Frank, what do you need?
Bullets.
He must have heard the shots. Wonders why I'm not coming out, so he comes in to give me a hand. I reload the gun. Put a pillow in the back of his head. And I empty the rest out in his face. You're almost at a bit of panicking right at that time.
Culotta does whatever it takes to get the job done, expecting that Spilotro will be loyal in return.
I drag him and I throw him into the pool. So wash anything evidence he had on him of me goes in the pool.
Frank Culotta and Tony Spilotro would only consider it a business situation. Whether they liked him or not, they felt that murder would have to be conducted in order to protect them specifically and the outfit in general.
Las Vegas police suspect that the outfit has something to do with the killing and numerous other crimes around the city, but they don't.
Everybody, how you doing? It's Joey back with you on Friday. Well, I gave you his name earlier, okay? Frank, the bottom line is this. We were together a few months back, and I just want to say it's wonderful to have the opportunity that you came out here and do my show. So I think we had a wonderful time last time. We just didn't have the time we needed. I didn't get those questions that I really wanted, that the people out there in radio land, they're like, Joey, man, I wanted to hear this. I wanted to hear that. I wanted to hear that. So today we got about 400, 500 questions that we're going to ask you in the next 2 hours. So I hope we can get
just
those
as long as you don't want me digging up any graves.
No, you're not going to dig up nothing. Right. Folks, don't he look good? I mean, for my radio friends, he's there's no glasses anymore. He's got the nice, his eyes are probably better than mine, and you look very handsome. I want to just start out with, let me see, I need my glasses.
You could borrow my reading glasses.
Yeah, nice.
Where'd
okay.
they go?
Yeah.
They fell on the floor.
They fell on the floor? All right, get them on a break. All right. Jaime Garcia. All right. It's a reserve. It's a beautiful, Nicaragua.
Why are you showing me that?
Well, because it's for you.
Well, thank you very much. I will smoke it.
You will smoke it. I know you will. And, you know, I picked myself one up. Maybe we'll smoke it together. I don't know. The bottom line is, my friend Frank is here. He's got a few books out. You can look all over the web and find him. We're going to talk about a lot of things today. And I'm going to ask the right questions is the bottom line. Right now, this is the book that's out there, Collada. True Life of a Chicago Criminal, Las Vegas Mobster, and Government Witness. Okay? I got to read it, which was nice, man. And I highly recommend it. I know you're grinning, but I'll kidding aside, I tell it the way it is. I highly recommend it. I really enjoyed it. Really easy read to get through. And this will be signed for me today by Mr. Collada. And let's just get to it right now, okay, in this segment. I want to start talking about things. I'll leave the weapons here. You can play with the dice if you want after a bit. These are just ideas. Born December 14th. I will not reveal the year.
Yeah, you're good. I don't care. I'm glad to be here.
I know you are. With the self-imposed nickname, the Las Vegas Boss.
Yeah, I don't know where they got that.
All right, well, someone got it, and someone posted it here, and I think it should be...
My nickname was the Brahma. That's what Tony called me, it's the Brahma.
Yeah? And what'd that stand for? What was that?
Bull.
Ah, the bull, man. Nice. Nice. The Brahma, you said?
Brahma.
Beautiful, man. Well, anyway, you know, that's what they call you here.
Yeah, that's fine.
They call you a lot of things. Friends. Frank was the enforcer for Tony Spilotro, Chicago Boys, man, the outfit. And I'm talking real deal here on the Joey Ciccone Show, the way it used to be. And I want to get right into asking Frank, right off the bat, the book, you got to get the book. Call in today when I release the number to you. If you have it, just kind of hold off. We need to talk to him a little bit. And Frankie, you know, I'm reading the book. All right, and I always tell you we had some things in common and everything, but mom and dad, Joseph and Josephine.
Right.
My mom's name is Josephine. All right? Then your brother's Joey.
All J's. I know where you're going.
It's Jay. It's just a nice
thing. My sister's name was Jean.
You know what I'm saying? Jean was your sister.
Another J.
Exactly, another J. Everyone. Yeah. But I'm just saying, the coincidence, Josephine, Joseph, and her. Let me ask you, where's the patch? These are ideas. What's the patch?
Are you talking about the patch, the neighborhood?
Exactly.
Actually, I wasn't from the patch. The patch is Taylor Street.
Okay. Okay.
I was from Grant and Ogden.
Excuse me for drinking that out of the bottle like that. But the bottom line is, yeah, Taylor Street's like, you know, the Italian street in Chicago, and we have the time of our life when we're over there doing our thing. But it wasn't that the patch was
Taylor Street.
Taylor Street was the patch. Okay. All right, well, you know, because I did my reading. I talked about the patch there. And if I can bring this up, your pop, he passed away in a car accident.
My father got killed, yeah.
Okay, your dad, you were what, 9 years old, I believe.
I was going on 9. Close enough.
So with Frank today, you know, I want people to see the other side of him. We see one side, and now, you know, I want to ask these questions. They're very important. And Frank, from you know what I read, you know your dad was a connected guy or a wise guy at least. He, correct? You molded yourself or followed after some of those footsteps, possibly.
My dad was a connected guy, but at that age, I only admired and envied my father. I didn't know what a gangster was at
exactly.
8 or 9.
Right.
And then after he passed on. Relatives, his friends used to visit my mother, and of course they talked about how great my father was. But being that I idolized him, of course I wanted to take after him, and that's how it all started.
Yeah, and you know, without I want people to read for their own, but I like to touch on certain things that you know, Dad basically had his way of doing things. You know what I'm saying?
It was
when I grew up, we got a little bit of this. You know what I'm saying?
No, we got a lot of that in my house.
Yeah, I'm sure. I know. I know. I'm just that's what I'm saying. Now you do it, and it's like, you know, you're under arrest. All right, but the bottom line is I wanted to touch on some of these things. They called it the Chicago outfit.
Right.
And they say it's the most dangerous outfit. Do you believe it was, is? Things have changed, obviously, but at that time, what's your take on that?
I'm second generation.
Okay.
So let me say this much. It was tough, and they were dangerous, and there was no room for mistakes. If there were, you were dead.
Okay. And exactly. And I don't want to cut ahead, but, you know, I did a lot of reading. By the way, your book prior before was Frank Collada, The Hole in the Wall Gang, and that's why I want to bring up that. You worked for whom here in Las Vegas?
Actually, I grew up with him, Tony Splacho.
Exactly. And
he wanted me to move here to Las Vegas.
And when you read, you know, for me, I'm dead serious, man, very heartwarming stories of growing up. And when you grow up, I'm sure when you grow up with a guy for that long, you know what I'm saying? And you've been around him that long, and you've gone through adult life, teen life, all these things, man. You know, there's a bond.
Absolutely. Okay. And my next book is going to have that all in there, and that's going to be about Tony Splacho.
Well, that's going to be nice. That's going to be a really nice thing. I saw something else, and I wanted to bring it up. You spent some jail time with Sam Giancana, and, you know, our listeners are out there are going, like, I'd like to know what that was about. I mean, I'd like to be in a cell getting some stories. I don't know. Was it stories? Was it serious? Can you share that with us, I mean?
Well, I met Sam Giancana prior to meeting him in jail two times.
Right, okay.
On the streets.
Okay.
He owned a lounge. They called it the Airliner.
Okay.
So he didn't work it, but he used to go in there. So I met him in there a couple times with Tony.
Okay.
Splacho.
Right.
When I went to jail in 1969, I had several cases pending.
Okay.
So I had to leave Stateville Penitentiary and go back to the Cook County Jail.
Right.
To go to court.
Okay.
And who was in there on one of my trips back?
Sam.
Was Sam Giancana. And I went on the same tier with him, of course. The assistant warden in that jail was a personal friend of mine.
Okay, yeah.
So when I came there, I had a lot of connections, a lot of clout, because the assistant warden was a friend of mine, as I said.
Right, but so, was that when you were, was Sam on the tier with you at the
right,
same time?
Right, that's what I'm saying.
Because Sam was getting the filet mignons and everything else.
I brought him to, I got the filet mignons, so.
Thank you.
I'm the one that's responsible for that. So when I came on there, because they had to be careful with Sam, because he had so much notoriety.
Of course.
So when I came on there, I sort of opened up the door, and I got all this food in. It came in through me, not through Sam.
Okay.
The stove and all that, like that shit you've seen in the Goodfellas. Well, we've done all of that before Goodfellas.
You know, and that's what I want to say. With a few minutes left in this segment, I want to just conclude with this, because we're going to talk, we're going to have fun. You know, after reading, sitting down and reading the book and everything, it was like reliving the Goodfellas again. You see what I'm trying to say?
It's copied off us.
So I'm saying the stories here were stuff that I saw there. And I mean,
before the movie was made.
Yeah. I know that. You know, and I'm just saying that you got to check it out, man.
I can tell you one scene in Goodfellas, too, where they cut the guy's throat in the trunk.
Yeah.
And he jumped out. I told that story before that movie was out.
It was about
Jimmy Moralia, the M&M murders.
That's what
aggravates me. Yeah. They copy everything I say.
Well, we're going to get all into that in the Joey Ciccone show here with my buddy Frank Collada. We're going to take a little break. We'll be back with Joey and Frank. Everybody, you're back with Joey Ciccone, the way it used to be. I got my friend Frank Collada here visiting me, the way it used to be, later on, the way it is, okay? And we got Frankie hooked up over here on some headphones. You're listening on the radio, got a little special treat. We got my buddy out of New York City, taking care of the Gotti family for a long time. John Alight. Johnny, how you doing?
Good, Joey. How are you? How's everything?
Beautiful, buddy. So good to hear from you. I'm sitting here with, I don't know if I should say fellow associate, but you know what I'm saying. So please, John Alight, say hello to Frank Collada. I mean, he's not a lot lost for words.
Well, I had to call in and say hello to Frank and really wish him well, and I love what he's doing. And, really, he's commendable, and guys like him make me do what I'm doing and following his footsteps and trying to do the right thing with our past. So, Frank, I really glad to know you and talk to you on the phone.
Well, it's my pleasure, buddy, my pleasure.
Hey, Johnny, we're looking for you to come out in November. We talked about that, and I know you're dealing with some things right now. Your book's doing well. Frank's books are doing well. Everyone's doing well. You know what I'm saying? Maybe I should write a book. I don't know.
You'll never get rich.
If they ask me, I could write a book. But Paisan, it's so good to you were just out there in Jersey, like with sharks and stuff. What were you doing? What was that about? Midnight,
you know,
I talked to you.
I'm catching up with life, and I have some good buddies of mine, a guy, Bob, that said he's going to take me deep sea fishing with the guy, Mike, and they promised that I'd come home, that they weren't going to leave me on the ocean. So
God bless,
I started
man.
On
That's right.
going out with them and doing something different. I never did it before. I had a ball. I had a great time.
Yeah, they don't let good-looking guys stay out there. They'll bring you back home. So.
Well, I just wanted to make sure I wasn't going to sleep fishing. You know, so
yeah, Gavish, I understand. That's good. But a lot of girls are calling in for your number. I don't want to give it away. So obviously I think the camera angle that day. I don't know, John. The bottom line, would you like to ask Mr. Kalat anything, share something, and we'll cut you loose? I know you got a busy evening.
Sure. You know, Frank, you know what? I want to ask you one question. And I know some of this in, you know, from some of my history and things. When Mike and Anthony were a little out of control, I was told, and you know, I heard that you tried to pull them back a little bit. You gave them advice prior to, you know, your situation. What was their comeback to you when you were trying to slow them down?
You thought about Tony and his brother Michael?
Mm. Yeah.
Well, Michael had nothing to do with Vegas. Michael's problems were all started in Chicago, and I did talk to Tony. I tried to talk to Tony. But you got to remember, when Tony's your boss, there's only so much you could say to them that'll listen. Because,
yeah.
you know, they
yeah,
always
well,
seem
I,
to think I, they know
I
better.
I know how that goes. That ego and,
That's
you
right.
know, you can only try to put it in gently and try to slow it down.
John, you know how that goes, right?
Oh, I know how that goes too well. Yeah, I definitely know how that goes.
Hey, listen, we're going to cut you loose, but I just wanted to say, when I was talking to Frank earlier, I said that, you know, you had did your time and you came out, and now you're like, dude, it's Miami, it's here, it's there, I'm snorkeling, I'm doing this. Do it up, brother. God bless. Enjoy life. We look forward to you in November, and hang out with Frank Kalat over here on his casino tour. We're going to take you around, and just have a great weekend, buddy, and thanks for calling, and I'm
hey,
sure Frank
welcome.
Enjoyed
thanks,
it.
Thanks, Frank, and I look forward to meeting you when I come down.
All right, talk to you later.
All right, thanks a lot, Lawrence. Appreciate that. All right, let's get back to business over here, all right? We got the books. We got some props over here. We left off with Gambino was in there, and so was that interesting? The interesting type of guy? I mean, I'm just trying to get Gambino.
Got nothing to do with him.
Huh?
Chicago and Gambino is different people.
Yeah, but I'm
Spacho.
No. Giancana, I apologize.
Oh, Giancana.
I apologize.
Sure, he was an interesting man. You respected him. You had to.
Yeah.
He deserved all of it. He was a boss.
He was a nice, quiet
guy. Guys like us would do anything for the boss.
Right.
We'd kill in a New York second.
Okay. And, I mean, jail, how was that for you? You know?
Jail is just an inconvenience.
Okay. And thank God I never made that trip, but... I'm sure it's not
it's
too much fun.
It's an inconvenience.
I hear you, man.
Toilet paper isn't readily available, nor soap.
Yeah, I saw pictures of you in the cell, you know, in the book and stuff.
Oh, I was living it up.
You looked good. It was nice. You had the good stuff, all right? What happened to Jimmy Hoffa?
There's a movie coming out. They're going to tell you all about it.
All right. I thought you might say something.
No, it's true.
All
this
right,
movie's
well,
good.
I believe you. Who took Sam out?
Tony Spacho.
Tony took Sam out.
Exactly.
Himself?
He had Sam's brother with him, Mario.
All right, but I'm saying, did he do it, or was it...
Said him and his brother, Mario. Mario's brother is Sam.
Okay.
Are you talking about Sam DiStefano?
No, I'm not there yet. I'm talking about Giancana.
I don't know who took him out.
Okay,
no
I'm
idea.
Just asking you the questions.
I have no
These
idea.
These people out there, they want to know. I got to ask the hard
well,
questions.
And I'm answering the hard questions.
All right, take
I
it easy.
Know.
Calm down. It's beautiful. I'm not going to get scared. I got things here. I don't care.
That don't mean nothing to
me. I know. What does skimming mean for people that love Italians and love mob stuff, but they don't know anything about skimming in
maybe,
Las Vegas?
Maybe if I explain this to them this way, they'll understand because
Tell
they
them.
Buy lattes. You skim.
Wow.
The cream off the top.
Yeah, you know what? I thought you could open for me. We'll be here through Thursday. Try the liver and onions. Frank Collada is going to be opening. It's wonderful, yes.
I don't like onions.
Yeah, they're skimming. Well, just tell them what happened. Your job was, when you were here in Vegas, you would step in. You dealt with casino people, right? Managers.
Yeah.
Correct? Help me out a little bit.
Okay. It's a long story, so I can't tell you all.
Well, we got time, but we don't have to go into the whole thing. But
it's
hard
to explain it all, but I could just give you a brief rundown.
Go ahead.
Skimming was in my part of the action. What I was to do. My job was to make sure nobody stole in the casinos. I knew about skimming. I know how it was going out of there. Not that I wanted to know.
All right, but all I'm trying to get at is skimming is what? Taking our cut.
And then they get.
Yeah, well, you know, the outfit's cut.
All right.
Okay, just to clarify, because I ain't getting fazools.
Okay, good.
Yeah, I mean, I'm trying to get something, but you ain't letting me get anything. So the bottom line is, the outfit gets its cut, right?
That's
and
right.
The rest goes to the casino. That's skimming, right?
Yeah.
I'm good on that? In the 70s, three casinos were controlled by the Chicago outfit. Frank, besides the Stardust, what were the other two?
The Fremont and the Hacienda.
You just heard it from Frank Collada here on the Joey Ciccone Show, the way it used to be. I needed to know that for myself, okay? You know, I didn't know. I knew the Stardust, the Fremont.
Hacienda. We also controlled the Marina.
Okay, so that was way before my time, I'm sure.
They were there all the same.
Well, you know, I'm 17, so. You know. Anyway.
I wish.
Anyway, all right. I'm going to keep moving on. You don't mind, do you?
No,
comfortable?
Go ahead.
Yeah, all right. It's beautiful, right? All right. When you go away, right, they say, and being an Italian guy, and it's not about movies or anything, but they're supposed to take care of your family. They're supposed to help you out when you're in the joint. I got to ask you the hard question. So did Tony help you out when you were in there? I know there's a lot of different arrests and stories. I don't want to give the book away, but there was a time when you were in there. Did he help you out?
No, he didn't come up with any money.
Okay, good. That was the answer, because that's what was in the book. Okay. you heard on tape, okay, and people want to know this. I have personal friends that are very much into this, and they're like, Joe, please ask. You heard on tape. You're going down. All right?
Yeah, what I heard on tape was, this is government let me hear the tape.
Right, we saw it in the clip.
And just read the transcripts.
Right.
And one guy was telling the other guy, me and Tony was talking to Joe Lombardo.
Sure.
And Tony was telling him that he couldn't control me. Joe Lombardo says, then you know what you got to do? You got to clean your dirty laundry.
Exactly. And that's, as we saw in the clip, or it might be coming up in the second part, but yeah, clean your dirty laundry. We ain't putting the jeans and the socks in the washing machine. That means you go bye-bye, okay? So 82, 83, 18 people on Fed racketeering, fingered Spilotro, okay? It's in the book. I'm just reading what's in the book. 80 to 81 robberies. There was a mistrial through this whole thing.
Yeah.
Am I correct, or did I, like, tired last night and fell asleep while I was on page?
You wouldn't fall asleep if you were reading my book.
You can't fall asleep reading the book. That's what I'm, you know, that's what I'm trying to tell
you. There was a mistrial because one of the jurors was overheard saying something about $10,000. So they thought one of the jurors was off for $10,000.
Right.
Which he wasn't.
Okay. All right. Beautiful, man. This is great. I'm moving right along. Where was Bertha's? And I ain't talking about the girl you took out like 15 nights ago. I saw you out. I saw you. Sapphire. He was over at the Sapphire.
It's all right. A strip joint.
Yeah, for all you people not here in Las Vegas, you know, this goes out everywhere. We have a lot of Vietnam people, and they don't know what Sapphire is, you know, but whatever. That was a joke. Where was Bertha's?
It was on Sahara in between Las Vegas Boulevard in Maryland Parkway.
Exactly. See, I did my homework. All right, I did my homework, all right? And you look at the picture, it was like a white, nice building and everything, right?
Right.
And they had nice things in there, right?
You bet. A lot of money.
Yeah. And you went in there, right?
Tried to.
And what happened?
Through the roof.
Yeah.
There was an informant that was infiltrated our crew.
Right.
And he was working with the feds and...
Well, we can say who he is, because let me see if I'm correct, all right? You want me to give it a shot?
Go ahead.
Sal Romano.
You got it.
Joey Ciccone. Sure, good. You think, too. Yeah. Well, you know what kills me is I saw you say this a few times. So, and I've sat with you in a studio. I've sat with you for dinner and everything. So you vibe things from a guy is what I'm trying to say. Because it plainly it comes out you didn't like the guy. There was something about him.
I didn't like the guy from the first day I met him.
Okay, and why? I mean, his attitude?
Because I didn't like the way he looked at me, the way he talked. Not to me.
Yeah.
It was a man hiding behind his eyes. And he couldn't look at you when he was talking to you.
Yeah.
I had a bad feeling about the guy, which I was right.
And that bad feeling, just to tie up this segment, that bad feeling turned into him causing a lot of problems because he was working with the FBI.
Well, Joe, they're probably wondering... Please. Why did I put him in the gang?
All right. Well,
I didn't
put him
in the gang.
I didn't say you did, but they want to hear.
Are probably assuming that.
Well, let's hear. Okay. Well, tell me. Someone else did.
Yeah. One of my partners in the burglary ring decided to fill him in without my knowledge.
Right. Again, here's what we do. Again, we get back to this Goodfellas film, but then I read here and. My point is this, for you to come through with this book and everything, they've got to go over it like 2, 3, 4 times. Make sure you ain't telling stories or lying. Or, and I'm no attorney, you're going back into the joint again if you're telling stories. So you got the truth happening here. You are listening to the Joey Ciccone Show, the way it used to be, every Friday from 4 to 6. I'm with mobster Frank Collada, Chicago, Illinois. We'll be right back. Everybody, you're back with Joey Ciccone and Frank Collada here on the Joey Ciccone Show, the way it used to be, Vegas All Net Radio. Having a great time. We're staying real strong with the questions, you know, trying to get the answers and just moving along here. Kind of left off with the mistrial we were talking about, okay? I got to ask you something now, all right? How do you break the Omerta code? What goes through your head? And without jumping ahead, but I need to just clarify it. You're sitting in the cell. What goes through your head after you listen to a tape that says get rid of your dirty laundry? Because you got to be sitting there, and it's mulling over your head. You know, I'm just...
Of course it's mulling over you. But you take your time, and you take it, and you weigh it. And you go in and you think about everything that happened. It's a decision that's very difficult to make because I was a product of my environment and we were taught that you never tell on your friend because if you did, you were no good.
Right.
So it was very difficult to do. And I did consider killing myself a few times while I was locked up because this isn't the world I came from.
Right.
But then I waited it all, and I thought, jail didn't frighten me in the least.
Right.
Jail is nothing, like I said. It's just an inconvenience. I didn't want to be one of them guys that's in the hole, 6 feet down in the ground, and as I used to say, what a stand-up guy. He don't know I'm saying that. He's dead.
No, he's gone. He's mort.
He's mort.
Right.
So I decided to do what I had to do, and okay. That was roll.
And without... any judgment or anything like that, nobody knows, especially out there, everyone listening right now today. You don't know until you're put in that situation.
Never judge somebody unless you walk in their shoes.
Okay, I love that. I love you saying that, and that's why you can't judge anyone because, you know, either you're going to go down or you got to protect yourself.
Anybody that makes statements like that, Joey?
Yeah.
They don't know what they're talking about. They're just talking out their butt.
Yeah, but Frank, there's a lot of people like that.
They all make statements. But then when I see them in person, it's a different story.
Yeah, I could imagine, man. They run off to the bathroom and things happen. All right? But I love you. Anyway,
remember this.
Go ahead.
Giuseppe.
Go ahead.
I never wore a wire.
That's true. We could touch on it. Go ahead. He never wore a wire. Basically, I got to explain these for people that, you know, I love the mob movies and I love this. This is real. A wire is basically a microphone that's hidden and everything's recorded.
You're a frustrated cop when you wear a wire.
Yeah.
You're a wannabe cop.
I got a wire on right now. Here, look. It's right here. But, all right, we got a few more seconds here. Right, we're good. We're good. We're beautiful, man. We're just we're asking the real questions. We want to know. Okay. Do you feel Tony set you up for a robbery? There was a lot going on in the book because, Frank, there's since you were a child, there was a lot of different arrests, different things, misdemeanors. Then finally turned where you had to do the 8 years. But I don't want to pick out the exact page, That might be a little bit too much for me, but do you feel he set you up on a robbery?
No.
Okay.
He didn't put me and walk me into a trap. No.
Okay.
I think he should have passed on it when I told him to, but I think he was just greedy.
Okay. And for our friends out there, when you're dealing in a situation like this, they don't really understand it. That the outfit gets their cut. They get their money. You do the job. You might not get too much. You'll get something, obviously.
They get 20%.
Okay, well, for sitting there and having the Anazette. Gabish, but I don't know. But anyway, I heard stories where they said he was having an affair with Rosenthal's wife, and he didn't want you to know that, or maybe pass the word back to Chicago, everything. True or false?
He didn't want anybody to know it, actually.
Okay, well, to silence you, was there maybe a chance that...
No.
Yeah. Okay.
Right. I defended it. See the movie Casino.
Of course. We're going to be talking about it, because you are the gentleman that they had on the set, and we're going to get deep into that. Right now, you're hearing a nice little Italian love song. Right now, do you want like a little dish of pasta or something? Maybe a glass of wine?
No, as a matter of fact, I ate just before I came.
Oh, you ate before you came. But then you're going to go out and eat again, though.
No.
After this.
Have a cup of wine.
All right, well, listen to me cantare in italiana. Al di là, Joey Ciccone, Frank Collada. We'll be right back.
Al di là della mite del mondo, ci sei tu. Al di là della volta infinita, al di là della vita, ci sei tu. Al di là, ci sei tu per me. La da da da, la da da da, la da da da. Al di là del mare più profondo, ci sei tu. Al di là della mite del mondo, ci sei tu. Al di là della volta infinita, al di là della vita. She said to her.
Joey Jacoby.
Everybody, Joey back with you. Friday. Wonderful Friday. I'm here with Frank Collada, my special guest. 2-hour program with Frank. I'm just loving it. We call this segment The Way It Is. Yeah, because this is what it is. Hey, there's somebody on the line there that I need to talk to. So who would that be?
Hello?
Is this Lola Ciccone?
Yeah, you're my roommate, too. Hi.
And your roommate. Hi, Kimberly. How are you?
Stevens Point.
Wisconsin, Stevens Point, right?
Yes.
What's your mascot over there?
The Pointers.
We're the Pointers. We're the dogs.
You're the Pointers.
Dogs.
I love it. The dogs. You're crazy. You're beautiful. Listen to this. It's your birthday, kid. Happy 18 years old. I wish I could go back to that time. It was wonderful. So real fast, from me to you.
Yeah, thanks, Dad.
And if you want to all join in, it's wonderful. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Lola. Happy birthday to you. I'm 18. I can do it. I'm an adult now. That's from.
Made me cry. Thank you.
Yeah, you're always crying. You know, that's what the Italian kids do. You got Miss Carr here, Helen Carr, singing for you. Lola, say hi to Daddy's friend. He's like Grandpa, Frank Collada. That's Lola out there in Wisconsin.
Hi, how are you? Happy birthday.
Great, how are you?
I'm
Thank
great.
Thank you.
Are you going to bring him some cheese? He wants some cheese from Wisconsin.
Yeah, we can bring you any type of cheese. The best cheese in the world here.
He wants to hide stuff in the cheese. You know what I'm saying?
You want the squeakiness. It's all about the squeakiness in the cheese.
Yeah, Kimberly, don't start bringing up Green Bay. We're on the air, okay? All right.
Green Bay Packers are 6-0. I can talk day and night about the Packers.
They're going all the way.
All right, Frank even said they're going all the way. Because right now I got a jersey that says Cutler. I can't wear it at all right? Listen, we love you.
You don't want to wear that.
We love you. I want you to have a wonderful birthday. I know you celebrated last night. Be safe. Okay, don't make me come out there. Frank will take a ride with me. We don't want to have to do it, okay?
All right.
I love you. Kimberly, we
love
you. And we'll talk to you guys real soon, okay?
Bye-bye.
Happy birthday.
Love you. Thank you. Bye.
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 Very nice. Yeah, you know, they turn 18 and, you know.
That's nice.
That's it. So she's doing pre-med up there and very happy that she's in a wonderful school. And the Midwest, that's where we come from, you know. That's the love. Everybody comes from everywhere out there. All right. And we're going to head for Frank's clip that was on Discovery, I believe. And it tells a very interesting story. Please play that.
Evidence yet.
It's a small town, and you're not going to get away with it forever.
Especially with a new lawman in town. Sheriff John McCarthy and his team vow to rid Vegas of organized crime.
And they swore that they were going to bring down Tony Splaccio and Frank Collada. They swore that they were going to end organized crime in Las Vegas.
McCarthy put Spilatro's crew under almost constant surveillance.
It was 24 hours a day they would follow us, but yet we were still able to commit robberies.
The mob is beating the feds at their own game.
One thing we had going for us as professional criminals, we had people monitoring their calls, the police calls, plus the detectives' calls. Any cops that were undercover, our radio system was top of the line. We had a better communication system than they did. So we were a step ahead of them at all times.
But Collada makes a mistake when he ignores the outfit and commits a crime solely for his own gain. Frank uses his gang to steal furniture for his own house.
They go in and they empty this whole place and they bring it to my new house.
A neighbor spots Collada and his gang suspiciously moving new furniture into his house.
The following morning at 6 a.m., my wife goes and answers the door. Everybody's there, the whole police department. And they took us both to jail, my wife in her slip and me in my robe.
It was this petty burglary that would eventually lead to the end of mob control of Las Vegas. The public arrest angers Culotta's boss, Tony Spilotro, and he refuses to pay Culotta's bail.
With all these problems, my relationship with Tony was strained.
While Frank Culotta was in jail, he was not making any money. And if you're not making any money, what good are you?
But Culotta has more than prison to worry about if he doesn't stay in Spilotro's good graces.
At this particular time, I had to find a scorer that was going to be well worth our while.
The payoff for Culotta must be big enough to give Spilotro a healthy cut and pay his own legal bills. Once he forks over the cash for his own bail, Culotta gets a tip about a local jewelry store.
And they said that this place could possibly have a million in jewelry and cash in there.
This could be the most lucrative heist in Culotta's criminal career. It could also be his last chance to keep Spilotro from turning on him. But Culotta is short a driver for the jewelry heist. His associate Ernie brings in a new man, Sal.
Well, Ernie meets this guy, Sal Romano. I didn't like Sal. For some reason, I had this gut feeling that the Sal guy was a bad guy.
Unbeknownst to Culotta, Sal is secretly working with FBI agent Dennis Arnoldi.
The FBI and the Metropolitan Police Department working together. It was through Sal Romano we learned of the burglary.
Sal was to drive the station wagon there, park it, and when they unloaded it, bring it to another spot. We had torches and all the equipment you would need to go through the roof into a vault. Larry, Sal, and I remained on the ground for communication.
Let's get the job done, okay? Let's get the job done. Sal, you hearing me? You in there?
Talk to me, Sal.
Suddenly, Sal vanishes.
I had no idea where he was. I knew he wasn't there. I said, this is something's going to happen. So I'm telling you, I got a gut feeling this guy's a rat. So I seen the car at the end of the block. And I said, that looks like the feds down there. Then they come in from all directions. And then they arrested me. And I seen that they had my three guys on the concrete out in front. They took them off of the roof, and they were cuffing them, with the exception of Sal Romano.
Thanks to his long criminal career, Frank is facing a possible life sentence. The arrest could also mean the end of his rocky relationship with his boss, Tony Spilotro.
I'm sitting in the Clark County Jail, and I'm sort of mad at Tony.
He had always been told if this happened to you, the outfit would take care of your wife and family. But his was not being taken care of. He needed an attorney, and he asked Tony Spilotro for help, but Tony would only come up with part of the money.
He never said, I'm sorry, I made the wrong call on this. He didn't help on any of the bails. Sure, I'm mad at Tony for not helping.
Frank knows that behind bars, he's a sitting duck as far as the outfit's concerned.
He knew being in jail, the outfit would think that he might possibly become a government witness and therefore would kill him.
So I'm sitting there and I'm trying to get over it. And then I get a visit.
The FBI brings a tape of a conversation they want Frank to hear, a warning that his life is in danger.
And that's when I heard that audio tape.
I'm telling you, we've got to do something about Frank.
One of the alpha guys in Chicago telling Tony, clean your dirty laundry.
Vegas, 1982. Frank Culotta learns his old friend and mob boss, Tony Spilotro, has put a hit out on him. He knows he must make a decision.
And I sat there and I started thinking and thinking. about how wrong things were going for me with Tony.
Realizing his promising future with the mob is unraveling, Culotta makes a life-changing decision.
I was angry. I felt as though I was betrayed. So I called the FBI. Then we sat down, and I gave him all this information that I had.
Culotta's defection is a major coup for law enforcement.
I worked very steadily with Frank Culotta from the time he became a government witness in 1982 for several years.
By 1983, Culotta's testimony led to the indictment of 18 people on federal racketeering charges, including Tony Spilotro. Culotta fingered Spilotro as the mastermind behind the Hole in the Wall gang, who the FBI believed committed at least 200 robberies between 1980 and 1981. Culotta also tied Spilotro to the Jerry Lisner killing.
Tony Spilotro and his associates were eventually indicted in federal court in Las Vegas, and they went to trial. The trial ended in a mistrial.
But Spilotro was also a suspect in more than 20 murders. With three more high-profile trials still to come, in 1986, he finally met the same fate as many of his fellow mobsters.
Not too long after that, Tony Spilotro and his brother were killed by their associates in the Chicago outfit. Both Tony and Michael had been beaten to death.
The Spilotro brothers were dumped in a grave in an Indiana cornfield. The film Casino recreated the killings in a scene considered one of the most violent in motion picture history.
I was not happy with it. Truly, I didn't like the idea the way they killed them. I figured if they wanted to kill them, why don't they just shoot them in the head or strangle them? Why beat them to death? You know, why make them suffer?
Spilotro's brutal murder ended an era in Las Vegas. The mob would never regain its power on the Strip. And in fact, Sin City cleaned up its image in the 1980s, billing itself as a family destination. Frank Culotta served 8 years in prison for his crimes. When released, Culotta joined the Witness Protection Program, leaving behind his Vegas lifestyle. It took years for Culotta to come to terms with his own decision to break the mob's code of honor he had followed for so long.
It's a very, very difficult decision to make when you grow up into a world like I grew up in. Everybody's honorable to everybody. It's the syndicate, the outfit that comes first.
But today, the infamous outfit is not nearly as strong as it once was. In the last 30 years, trouble with the law leaves only about 50 made members, down from approximately 300 during the outfit's heyday. For Culotta, Hollywood came calling, and in 1995, in addition to appearing as a hitman known as Curly in Scorsese's Casino, he became a consultant on several TV shows and films. Today, Culotta lives with the consequences of his actions, but he'll never find peace.
Do I consider myself a rat? Absolutely.
Hey, everybody. Joey Ciccone back with you with Frank Culotta here in the studio. Vegas AllNet Radio. We're getting right back into it. You saw a nice little documentary there on Frank. Real quick, I want to just show you a few things here. I know you're listening to me on the radio, so you can't see me right now, but the book Culotta, The Life of Chicago Criminal, Las Vegas Mobster, and Government Witness. I highly recommend it. Cool book. Amazon, Barnes & Noble. Go to Frank's site. What's the site, Frankie?
HoleInTheWallGang.com. Biz.
Oh, you got that? Very good. Okay. Go there. Then he's got the book that was before this one. It was Frank Culotta, Hole in the Wall Gang. It was his gang. Okay. Used to go in through the side, blow up things and go in. You know, they didn't have alarms. It was a different time. All right. I know. It's beautiful. Here, that's his book. We're getting them signed. Yeah. We ordered them like 9 months ago and now we're getting them signed. Okay. All right. We'll be getting that done. All right, now this segment, my lovely, lovely friends out there, you're gonna love this because you're gonna you hear Frank with the wit and everything, and you know I love it because it's like I'm ready for like a beef sandwich, you know, sit in Chicago, hang out, and this is called Fun with Frank. Yeah, you're going to love it, babe. You're going to love it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to name some things because I sat there at the library and read the...
It's my bookmaker.
Mr. Collada's phone is ringing while we're on the air.
That's okay.
$25,000 on that, please.
Be 15 to go on. Hey, Aaliyah.
I love it. It's classic. It's beautiful.
Let me shut this off.
Yeah, well, we ain't going to tell him to shut it off. He's going to do it when he's ready to shut
Very
it off.
Rude
you understand?
To call me.
It's all right. You shouldn't call right now. You're busy. All right. Bottom line is fun with Frank. Are you ready for it? Lawrence, give me a little drum roll or something, please. Yeah, you got to get some more sounds there, man. All right. Bottom line is this. Here we go. Okay. Easy. Over there, cowboy. Here we go, Frankie. October 11th, 1979, 2303, Rawhide Avenue, Las Vegas.
Not funny.
Things happened. You want to talk about it? I was just bringing up the address and the date.
Well, first of all, when I talk about murder, I did get immunity. And I could talk about this particular murder. And this was of a Jerry listener. He was a government informant.
Exactly, sir. Exactly. And we talked about it, you know, a few months back and everything. We went through the whole process of, you know, what went down there. And when we talk about Casino, the movie, we're going to touch on a part there. Montefiore School.
Montefiore.
Did I say Montefiore?
Yeah.
All right. What about it? You know, like I see what I do is, you know, get to learn Frank. I ask and then you finish it, you know.
Okay, I'll finish it.
What was it?
Tony and I went to the school. It was for bad boys.
Bad. Real bad.
They didn't want to listen.
Didn't want to listen.
95% black.
Yeah. I know.
3% Hispanic.
Yeah. You guys
2%
took
2% poor white guys.
Yeah. You guys took a beating.
They took a beating.
I read thing, but they started out giving beatings, and then you guys.
Yeah, they tried.
Gave
we
beatings.
Went to jail. I went to jail for it, too.
All right. Okay. You can't say nothing to Mr. Collada. You just move on with the next one. Pizza Palace.
Yeah. That was old memories.
Memories.
That's right. We hung there.
That was your hangout in Chicago, right?
Well, for a while, yeah.
All right. Mad Sam.
DiStefano.
Exactly.
Lone Juice Man.
Right.
Put out money on the street. The biggest one in Chicago.
Really?
Yeah, he was the biggest one. Make about $2 million a year in juice money.
Now, didn't you do a little bit, coming up, didn't you do a little bit of that where you were like, you know, I read you were
I
like.
I tried it for a year.
Yeah, and then you had to go hunt everybody down to
yeah,
go get the
too
money.
Too much work.
You know, where's Johnny at? Where's he at? I got to go find him over here. No, he's over here. You owe me the money. You know, it's the whole thing.
Yeah, I didn't like it.
Back and forth. M&M Boys.
Famous murder. Chicago murder. Billy McCarthy and Jimmy Moralia.
Okay, if you can tell, you can let the people out there in Rio Land know.
If you buy the book, you'll see it in the book. They both got murdered very viciously. And it was just terrible. They got beaten to death, tortured, and I was a part of it.
Right. Now, was that the part that was in Casino, which we're going to get to here shortly?
The head and the
with
vice?
The vice?
Yeah.
Yeah, your eyes. It fixes your eyes. But anyway, Bertha's, we talked about that, what happened over there. You know, it's just fun. Like, I say something, and then you finish it. It's great. Are you loving it?
Yeah, unless you don't want me to finish.
No, I want you to finish. I want you to finish. But you know,
I like to make jokes.
To
you know what I mean?
Yeah, funny. Yeah,
let's do it. And it's
yeah. I'm here to amuse you. Yeah, good.
What for me?
I'm here to amuse you.
Thank
all right.
you very much,
Leo.
That's what you're supposed to do.
Leo, Ernie, Wayne, and Larry.
Yeah, they were part of the hole-in-the-wall gang.
Exactly. And if you saw that clip, Frank talks about them there, and each guy had a purpose. You know. One guy was good with tools, right?
Yeah, we were all good in our own field.
Right.
Whatever it was.
What'd you do, like, go around and, like, you know, I gotta get, like, a good guy that's good with tools or, you know?
I knew who they were. I didn't have to check around.
Okay.
So when I put this crew together of guys, I knew exactly who to get.
All right, but out of respect, that's something we talked about, you know, like, you know, I'm showing you all this love and everything, you know, and then I get, like, a little morsel here and there. But out of love, then, wouldn't you be considered, the boss of the Hole in the Wall gang?
I was.
Okay. So that comment that was made is destroyed, and I just destroyed it right now. All right?
What comment?
The one we talked about earlier. We'll get it. That you weren't a boss. You were a boss of the Hole in the Wall gang.
Yeah, but okay. I had a boss, I had to speak to.
I understand that. You say you never liked Listener, right? You never liked him, right? He was a
no,
FBI
like
informant,
him.
Correct?
Yeah, well, at the time he wasn't. When I first met him, he wasn't.
Yeah, but you had strange feelings with him, too.
Well, I got information from an attorney that was defending him, that he was testifying in Washington, D.C., in front of a grand jury about Tony and me.
Okay, so can we talk about, you know, what happened on that date, or you didn't want to touch on that, October 11th, 1979? Yeah, we talked about it before with no problem. So the bottom line is you're asked to go over there and take care of business and do
yeah,
what
I was
you
told.
Do.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're told. So you go over there and you do what you got to do.
Exactly.
And the bottom line is, you know, I mean, what I'm not going to do is tell you everything that's in his book, because I want you to buy it and read it, and that's what Frank wants also. But I'm just trying to touch to feel the man a little bit more and find out some things that you might not know. And with that being said, you go in and you basically, you know, put a few rounds in this guy.
Like 12.
Yeah, but now what I'm reading is, like, that wasn't a full bullet. Am I right or wrong?
Half loads.
Yeah, why? They're half why? Can you, because here's why. I know why, but the people out in radio land and stuff, they don't, like, know, like, why that was done.
Supposedly to keep the sound down, the noise down, but that didn't work.
No, because the bullet comes out, then not, you know.
You're going to get the blast.
Not as powerful.
Maybe not as powerful, but as noisy.
All right, but he didn't. But the bottom line of the story is it didn't put him down, and you had to do some extra work.
Right.
And then Wayne came in and gave you a hand there, and then the guy went for a swim.
That's correct.
Would that be correct?
Yeah.
Okay, so.
We went swimming with him.
You went in there with him?
Yeah.
Mika, you
I got the guy's blood all over me. I got to get it off.
You had to get it off.
So DNA.
Yeah, so what'd you do then? Did you change then, or what happened?
I walked out of the house naked and jumped in the work car.
Minka! All right, and we're going to get into that with Frank, because we're going to talk about coming up. You know, he's got a wonderful tour here with the holidays coming up. We're going to be getting into that. We're going to be talking about the movie Casino, okay? The bottom line is this man was a consultant in it. Not just that. Again, doing my homework, he played the lovely character of Curly, okay? And that Curly, it says it right on the documentary, Curly was the character.
That's the documentary messed up. I don't know where they got Curly from.
Hank, really?
Yeah, the end of thing they called the pitmen in the movie goons.
Okay, but the guy says Curly on there, am I right?
Yeah, that's, I don't know where they got.
See what happens? You start studying.
You could see my hair? It waved goodbye a long time ago.
Minka, because you could be, you know, it's great. I tell him stories, and he's like, I don't know where that came up with. I don't know where that came
People
up with.
People create stories.
Curly is what they call the guy. All right, so we're going to be getting back into that with Mr. Collada. We're going to see a nice little clip now that's going to be coming up from the movie he was a consultant in. Not just that, he actually plays a role in there, if he wants to talk about it, where he relives.
Do you remember who played
the
part in the movie?
Of course.
Who?
Mr. Vincent.
Attaboy.
He's just trying to stump me, folks. You know, like I fell out of a tree. All right? Let's see this Casino clip. Martin Scorsese. It's the 20th anniversary. All right? Let's see this, baby. Everybody, Joey Ciccone back with you. Frank Collado. Frank, you're texting right now?
Go ahead. I got time.
All right. Go ahead. No, go ahead. You can finish it up, man, if you want. You can finish it up. You know, here's what we need to talk about. We just saw that wonderful clip. Now, we want to talk about a few things. Remember that story you told me? So how'd they come up with the Tangiers again? Because we're talking about the movie Casino, 1995, and basically it's story of Spilotro, Rosenthal, and you were basically telling me, like, you know, you're a key figure in there, but you were low-key. It was more of a low-key thing. You had to keep a low profile, let's put it that way. Would I be correct wording it that way?
No, but, you know, I got to tell you where it was. Nick Pelleggi is the one who got a hold of me. He's the one who wrote the screenplay.
Right.
The book Casino and so on.
Exactly.
And he got me in the movie. In his own words, he said the movie could have never been done without my input.
Right, so you were the consultant on it.
And then I got myself into it as an actor.
Exactly, that's what I want to talk about, because I caught that. Most people might not catch that. So now, Scorsese, first of all, we need to talk about that, because I worked with a lot of directors. He's one I've always would love to work with. So, you know, it ain't over till it's over. But what kind of guy?
He's a guy that demands a lot of respect from people around him. Nobody could just go up to him and talk to him. The only ones that talk to him usually are the other directors.
Yeah.
Nobody else. And maybe the producer. I was able to sit next to him through the whole screening of the movie and give him input on the movie.
Okay, right. Right, you
and
kept giving him the input.
People in turn wondered who the hell I was. They didn't know who I was.
Right, but let me ask you something now. Were you seeing things where, nah, man, nah. That wasn't how it was done. This is how it was done. Was that type of thing? That's what happens.
Certain things, yeah, I told them, and then they changed them around.
Right, but you're always going to come with that. With the, you're always going to put the Hollywood vibe in there. You know what I'm trying to say?
Of course.
You know what I mean? Where
it sells.
Yeah, it sells, and there was, like, you know, so things are accurate, but it's more with Hollywood involved.
Joey, as you well know, if anybody's life was written as it is, it'd be boring.
It'd be boring, exactly.
So you have to put in.
You got to make it a little bit, obviously, very interesting, and the movies do that. So, consultant on that, Frank Vincent played you in that.
Correct.
You know, did a marvelous job. He's a
did a good job.
Wonderful actor. Yeah. You hung out with the De Niro, Pesci. Right?
Yeah, I got along.
That had to be
a
gas, right?
Sharon Stone, all of them.
Yeah, Sharon Stone.
I met them prior to the movie.
Yeah, but Sharon Stone, every time I saw a picture with you, you know, you were like, you know, on her neck every 2 minutes.
Well, yeah. I guess you would be, too.
Yeah, I guess I would. I would. She's a
sweetheart.
She's
very
a beauty.
Intelligent woman.
Right. So now me, you know, doing my homework and everything, so this is what I had. You said it's wrong, so let's clarify it. You played a character called Curly, but it ain't no dude called Curly, so it's a hitman. You're actually in the scene that you saw their friends from Casino just now. Frank whacks a guy in the back of the head. Who is that? Steve Allen? Not Steve Allen. Trying to think of the actor's name that you killed.
I don't know. He was just an actor.
Yeah, no. He's somebody.
I don't know who he was.
All right, okay.
By the water fountain?
No, I don't. He's walking by the car. You
was,
shoot him and you keep shooting.
Oh, that was Alan King.
I knew it. I said Alan. Did I say Alan?
It was Alan King.
All right.
No, I killed Alan King in a parking lot. The guy in the car was a dealer in the hotel.
Right, right.
I kill everybody in the movie except
okay.
the guys at the end.
Right, but let's talk about this. Let's talk about this. This is what I've seen here from what I read. So, and we want the facts. So the bottom line is, they're shooting the scene with Lister, right? They're doing the scene, and maybe things ain't really working out right on the set. And correct me if I'm wrong, but they're like, everyone take a break or whatever. Did you or did you not go in and play that role as a hitman and enforcer, basically reliving something that you've already done?
Yes, that's right.
Okay. All right. So you basically...
The first man ever to portray an actual...
First man on the moon?
No. You want to listen or you want to bust my
balls? Well, you've been breaking them, so I'll give a little bit back.
The first man ever to portray a killer... A killing that he actually done in real life
right.
on the screen.
Right. And you know, here's the thing.
And get away with it.
Yeah, I know. Here's the thing. Right, exactly. And get away with it. I love that. But, I mean, you know, we joke and everything else, but the bottom line, I've been on sets for 30-something years and everything. And so Scorsese's like, Frank, just go in there and do what you did. Is that how it goes down,
you
or what?
You just go do what you got to do.
Yeah.
So there was no takes and retakes.
You just reenacted.
I was the quickest one of all of them.
Yeah. It went 1, 2, 3. You're like deja vu.
You just do I've what been you got to do, Joey.
I've been here before. It feels so natural. Okay, so and you're doing that part, and then you're whacking people in other parts, and Casino, it's fantastic. We love it.
Good movie.
I would have liked to see you have a bigger role, you know what I'm saying? But like you said,
I'm not, you got to be De Niro or Pesci or...
Well,
they're the stars, not me.
I think what you explained was that, you know, the story was with Anthony and Rosenthal, that relationship, and you have to... You know,
it was about Lefty, the movie.
Lay low, yeah.
Real That's nice. What the movie was about.
Right, and we shot here in Vegas, our lovely town, Las Vegas. And how long was the shoot? And how long were you on the set?
6 months.
All those people, were you there the full 6 months?
Yep, every day.
Blessings,
7 days,
man.
A week.
Blessings. Very good. Now, we talked about this a few months back. I want to touch on your tour because I really want to push this. So I need you to go ahead and give all our listeners the information out there that they would need to book a tour. Please explain the tour, where it starts, what it goes through. You know, a light's going to come out and he's going to say, "Joey, let me take it. You know, take me to the tour and let's go check it out." So we want to push that, and it's the Casino tour. Am I correct?
Yeah, it's Casino Tour. Frank Colletta Casino Tour.
Okay.
20th anniversary.
Right, the 20th anniversary of the movie. And please take us through, if you could, what the tour consists of.
Well, on that particular tour, I bring the people to the Mob Museum. We walk, I have an ex-FBI agent walk them around the Mob Museum along with a tour guide. That's about 2.5 hours.
At the Mob Museum.
Out, and then they get out and they jump on a bus and we take them for a ride around Las Vegas, showing them all the spots that murders were committed and the scenes from the movie were done.
Right.
And that's another 2.5 hours. Then we bring them for our pizza.
Yeah, you have a little pizza, all right.
Pizza.
Yeah.
And then I make them all buy books for me. That's where I make my money. They don't go back home unless they buy a book.
I know, but what I'm trying to say is, like, do you force them or do you just
I force them to buy my book. I tell them you ain't going to get a ride back.
Yeah, see, man, that's how you... This, for all our listeners, that's how you sell books, all right?
They love me.
With fear, yes. They fear you. That's just fantastic.
You know, Joey, at first the air scared of me.
Well, Frank...
No, wait a minute. Let me finish.
Let me know when I could talk. Go ahead.
Okay, you take a walk out the room. I'll finish this. They're scared of me when they first see me, but I make them like me right away.
Yeah.
Then they calm down and they like me, and by the end of the tour, I can wind up with the guy's old lady.
Well, it's nice. Well, that it sounds good to me, and possibly free cigars. I don't know.
I don't get those. I wish I did get cigars.
You got one today.
No, I got lucky.
Yeah. Well, you're a lucky
guy.
You
can talk now. No. I'm going to bust. You'll never want me on the show. Put that gun down.
All right. We're here with Frank Colletta, enforcer for Anthony Spilotro. Okay? Those times had to be kick-ass, man. I've seen you saying, "I lived the life." See? Look at
him. I was just scratching your finger.
Yeah, the emerald. The emerald. Good. You want to throw while we're at it, throw the emerald story in.
Emerald.
The emerald story. We had to take, the girl wouldn't take the emerald ring off.
I had to bit it off.
Did you bite it off or no?
I didn't grab it. My partner, though.
Man. I seen that thing where the girl had the beautiful ring. I don't take my ring and my emerald ring. Come here.
That was in the book, yeah.
Yeah, it's in the, I don't like to give everything away, but I like to touch on things, all right? We talked about this last time. Let's go back to the tour. Let's talk more on it.
Go ahead.
All right. That
whole tour takes about 5.5-6 hours. Then I have another tour, casino tour. Just call it casino tour.
Right.
That's 2.5 hours.
Okay.
In other words, it costs less money to go on that tour than it does.
It's a little bit shorter, or you know pizza?
2.5 hours shorter. You get a pizza. I give you a pizza.
Yeah, you get a pizza. You get thick crust?
Yeah, it costs me like $40 for them pizza.
Chicago style or New York?
You think things are free?
Some things in life are free, all right?
You know, that was still a long time ago.
What?
Anything free is no good.
Well, there's a good point. There's a good point to that. You know, there's sometimes things behind that. Frank, let me ask you: do you have peace with yourself?
I do now.
Okay. I know they're asking me. They're like, Joey, ask it, and then you are going to be able to call in at 702-483-4444. Talk to Frank Collada. You could say hi to me too. It'd be nice. They don't want to call in. Yeah, they're scared. Don't worry about it. I'm not scared. What if you had to do it again a minute? Let's just go back here a minute before we step out of this segment. Leave us with, what if I had to do it again? What would it
be? You know, that's a difficult question. You know
why? Is it a good question?
Yeah. But you know why it's a difficult question?
Why?
I'd have to be brought up in another neighborhood, have a different parents.
It is true, and
so how can I answer it?
Well, it is true, and with all due respect, I think when they read and they see how you were raised, you know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah.
And the things that you went through, and
my mother tried.
Yeah. Josephine, beautiful.
She tried.
And the bottom line is, man, is that you know, it was a different time. If you had to do it again, I just did want to ask you, you know, would you do things different, possibly? We're going to hear a song, but just answer the question.
I refuse
Mr. Collada, answer the question.
I refuse to answer the question.
Are you pleading the fifth?
On the grounds that tend to incriminate me.
On that note, Joey Ciccone with Frank Collada. I got a song for you called Volare. We'll be right back.
Volare.
Sono così, non le tarde ma più. Mi depingeva le mani e la faccia di blu. Poi improvviso venivo da venne rapito. Incominciavo a volare. Cielo benvenido, volare, oh, oh, oh. Cantare, oh, oh, nel blu, dipinto di blu, felice di stare lassù, e volavo, volavo, felice più in alto del sole, ancora più. Mentre il grande pian piano spariva lanzano laggiù. Una musica dolce suonava soltanto per me. Volare, oh, 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 oh. Cantare, oh, oh, oh. No wonder my happy heart sings. Love has given me wings. Nel blu, dipinto di blu, felice di stare lassù. Into the blue, felice di stare là.
Yeah, how I got it. Joey Ciccone back with you. The way it used to be, the way it is. In the house today, Frank Collada. We got this book here, Collada. We got the Hole in the Wall gang. He's buying the wine tonight. I'm just letting them know right now. Bottom line is this, because I was reading this, and we got to work with the time and everything. What was your first car?
A 1958 Oldsmobile, 98.
That is correct. That is correct. Then I read this, which I got to see. We'll see if it's... You'll probably tell me, no, someone made that story up, too. They say all the cars you had, you know the license plate numbers.
No, I know my prison numbers.
I knew that, and I know the Joey Ciccone Show, 702-483-4444. So you don't read. But you had a lot of cat. Remember, you seen the Eldorado and stuff, and you're like, Joe, I had this Cadillac. I had that one. Yeah. You always had three new cars a year, correct?
At least.
Right? This is what I was reading, okay? All yeah. right. All right.
Car buff.
Right. I love it, too, baby. I love it. Check it out. Robbed an outfit guy, because I got to just touch on this. Then when he found out, when you found out that it was one of the guys from the outfit, right? Did you go and talk? I think, was it Lombardo, maybe?
No.
Okay, I was wrong. All right. But you let them know that. I didn't know, right?
Of course, yeah.
Okay? And so now you return everything.
Right.
And you return the $500.
Correct.
And Kistuka says that it's $5,000.
Correct.
All right? So just shine just a little bit on it. So basically, he was a bookie, and he was what?
Robbing $4,500 from him.
All right, enough said there, right. Beautiful. You like to kill people?
No.
It's that's done. That's a part of your
it's
life
a day
that's
in
ended.
My past.
What's the feeling like? People will ask
at
you
the
this.
At the time, you try not to think about it. You're happy to get away with the murder. Right. And not get caught.
There's a part. Now, we were talking about your eyes, okay? And I just got to touch on it.
What a book.
Then we'll move in there. But, yeah.
I know where he's going with this one.
No. We'll see if you do, if
it's
you saw my note.
My book is honest. I don't lie.
All right, well, you can't. You can't lie right. because they tell
Answer
you right there you can't
so I
lie.
Can get it over with.
All right, so you're in the house now, and then you
house.
Think
oh, God.
You're in some place, and you're thinking it's a guy, and maybe you're going to shoot
him. Yeah, that's a tavern.
But tell them what it is. It's a is it a mannequin?
No. It's a coat rack with a hat and a top coat on it.
All right, so
it was dark in the place. I had no glasses on. It was like the three blind mice.
Let me clarify, Mr. Collada here, because you know I did some heavy reading here, but now he clarified it for you. But it's a coat rack.
I was
friends.
16 years old.
His eyes are like you know. So now he just had the you know he's got the new eyes now. Now they're like 16 now. But I don't know if they're like 16 now. Your eyes, your new eyes.
They're like 16.
They're like 16 years old.
When I was 16, I was as blind as I ever was. Now
oh,
I can
not,
see
not,
like
wow.
I never could see. Yeah.
So you took the glasses off to go in and do what you
right,
work.
Right, I had to take them off.
Why? Did you think girls were in there and you didn't?
Well, two of us ran in there with shotguns. You know, we weren't looking for any outbreaks. We were looking to get the money.
A coat rack. All right, that's all I want to say, a coat rack. All right. I've just had so much fun. I could go on for 2, 3, 4 days. I want to mention some things here. I have... Deacon Jones Foundation, his lovely wife, Elizabeth, coming back on to talk about a nonprofit organization, which we're going to be doing some things with, which is a lovely thing.
I donate to St. Jude's.
St. Jude's is beautiful. St. Jude's
That's
is...
That's where we donate.
You got to. Everyone from Chicago
Proceeds
is like St. Jude's.
For my tours.
Right.
For my books.
Right. And they send
so
they
it's
send
all
you,
not profit for me, you know.
Right, and they send you the stuff and everything to stamp what you're
I have somebody
it.
That works for me that does that.
Really? Okay.
I'm a little higher up there now, John.
I see that, man. You're moving up as we go along.
I might
I'll tell
keep
you
all
right
the
now.
Money. I don't trust myself.
I think you will, man. I think you really will. Half of that show is gonna be some lovely showgirls. I'm gonna have some of these pinup girls. They're lovely. They're gonna come back and hang out on the show. Maybe Collada drops in. Maybe he calls.
You won't have no girls then.
Well, I don't know.
I'll leave the show.
We'll see what. Well, that'll be true. Right away, I'll be taking them out of here. That's going to be my show for next Friday at between 4 and 6. Mr. Collada, we'd like to get our book signed.
Get the marker out.
We got it. We're using the nice gold marker right now.
Jesus.
Is it? What?
Come on, give me
No, I think you wanted a silver one, didn't you?
You got this on.
Where's the silver marker at?
Camera?
Yeah, is it all right?
Yeah.
Yeah, J-O-E-Y.
J-O-E-Y. My brother's name is Joey.
Like your brother. I know. I told you that like 2 hours ago. But I know you want that one signed too. We're getting it. Listen, while Frank's doing this, he does signings, the casino tour with the Holidays. You got to come check it out, okay? You know, maybe they'll have me sing a Christmas song or a carol or something, standing in the yard of, Rosenthal's house. Who knows? Definitely check that out. Buy his books. We've known each other for about a year or so, but the time that I've spent with him has been pretty interesting. Of course, we're from Chicago, so
it's a date.
We connect. Yeah, it's my daughter's birthday, sir. October 23, 2015. Thank you, Mr. Collada. This would be for Miss Helen Carr, if you could. We have 2 minutes. Right now, you have a chance. 702-483-4444. Give Frank a call. Say something to him. Don't be scared. Now, when's your next signing, Frank, while you're doing that? If you could.
Every time I take the bus out on a tour. Tours are every Wednesday.
Tours are every Wednesday. What time are the tours?
Start at 6 o'clock at night. The museum tour starts at 1 o'clock in the afternoon.
All right. And so,
and that's on a Wednesday also.
Right, and I've seen, like, they had, like, a bus. Is there, like, a screen on there, too, like, showing stuff?
Yeah, we have a monitor.
Am I right?
There.
That's nice. Is that your own bus for the tour?
No. We rent it from Bell Transportation.
Cool, man.
Plus,
nice.
We give the people champagne.
Oh, man, that's
nice.
On
the museum tour.
No, I love it, man. I love it. Yeah.
Otherwise, they get nothing.
Okay, so now, how do they get tickets?
You're going to call up... What's it? I don't even know the name.
Oh, the girl's name. Yeah.
The name is Becky. The number is 702-677-9015.
Call up. Give Becky.
Mention my name and you get a discount.
Call up Becky. Get the tickets. The man right here, the consultant for casino. All right. Story of his life here, man. It's pretty heavy duty. I read it. I highly recommend it. It's going to be on the new Joey Ciccone bestseller list.
Mention Joey Ciccone's name.
That's
so they
right.
Know.
Please, you know, give me a little bump there. I'm looking forward to my guest next weekend. I want to thank you for tuning in. Frank, thank you so much.
You're welcome, Joey.
For being here. We really appreciate you signing and sharing the stories with us and, you know, telling the real truth. Joey Ciccone's signing off.
Remember
the way
that?
It used to be.
Oh, shit.
The way it is.
I was just starting.
Frank Collada, he talks over you. He don't care. I'll see you next weekend.